right to go build those trails. So, you know, Broomfield could say, we don't want to allow them to come from our community into the refuge, or any other community can say that, but that hasn't been the position at this point that's been taken.
Yeah, the question I was going to ask is, up until last April, the maps, year ago April's stewardship council meeting, the maps of the trails went around the perimeter of Rocky Flats. They came through Broomfield, they ended at Indiana, they went north to 128 and across 128 and then on into the Boulder open space. Something changed at that meeting where this grand plan to go through Rocky Flats was announced. Any idea? I'm sort of piggybacking on his question. Even if 12 years ago, the powers that be believed that opening that refuge was a good idea, if the citizens no longer believe that, what would be your suggestion of how the citizens can make their voices known?
Well, I mean, good point. I mean, go ahead.
I'm not planning to really get into that question. I'm a Broomfield staff person, so it's a little awkward for me to discuss that. I think, Pat, if you want to talk about how citizens can get involved in
because
I think that's probably better.
Because I think, you know, at this point in time, because part of the goal here was not necessarily getting, I mean, Kristen and the staff had some, you know, meetings or information meetings where they got staff input. My understanding is Fish and Wildlife is doing the same thing, you know, and either through emails to Kristen or whatever, she can, you know, she can give you opportunities to speak. But she, at least our group, the Broomfield Open Space Foundation, she lets us know of all the meetings that are occurring, you know, because this purpose of this wasn't necessarily to be public policy. It was more to be, you know, information and talk about a baseline. And I understand the desire to advocate, you know, particularly in our society right now, we all want to advocate at everything we do, and so, but that wasn't necessarily the purpose here to be a public hearing. And so, Chris, you know, like I said, Kristen's, her address is kpritz@broomfield.org.
We just sent out a notice about the sharing session that Fish and Wildlife Service is promoting on May 15th at the Arvada Center. Right. What is the topic? Safety of the refuge. It's come up 6:30. It's come up at every meeting that the Fish and Wildlife Service has hosted to the public, for the public, on this refuge and some of these improvements. So I think that's a really good place to come in and talk about your concerns. I do want to respond to your comment about the trail change. Originally, and I think I'm aware of the alignment you're talking about, even though I don't have the map right in front of me. So the crossing was going to be here, again at the southwest corner of Broomfield, across Indiana, go up here across Walnut Creek, where our monitoring station is.
Before that alignment, that's the original alignment. What you're speaking of is the alignment they originally announced in April.
Yeah.
Before that, it never entered the refuge at all. It went on the surface street.
And I'm not sure what map you were looking at, so I know I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but the conservation plan shows a crossing here going into the refuge, and I think the visitor center was actually more over here.
It's on the west.
Yeah,
on the west side.
It was over on
the ranch.
Over here?
Right.
Way over there, okay. And then there was another, I don't know exactly where it was down here, another access point down in this area that brought trails in around here. So it was kind of a horseshoe. And then there was the April trail, which I guess it was April, crossed here and went up. We had great concerns about the trail crossing where our monitoring facility is located. We did not think it was a good thing to bring people near that monitoring equipment and so on. So we had many discussions with the other governments about why we did not want that location. That's why we requested this access and coming this way and around. But you know, it was definitely more trail, more expensive, and that created some issues for others. I'm sorry, I don't know specifically the trail that you're talking about, but there has been an evolution of the trail alignment, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
I just have a question, like, with all the construction, if you will, that's gonna happen between building the building and the trails and all that, and the prevailing winds coming from the west, has anybody looked at the impact of dust flow increases?
Numerous studies.
Can you repeat the question?
It was a question on the, if you're building the buildings and doing the construction of trails, what about dust mitigation? I mean, you know, so.
They've never found, to my knowledge, they've never found any plutonium outside of that reddish brown area.
No, that's not true.
Did you have a question or a comment?
I have a compliment I want to give to Broomfield for attempting to reroute the trail for the Greenway connection to a safer location. My disappointment is that you relented and let the other five participants say, no, that wouldn't work because your routing was a safer routing. And then I do have a comment to the residents of Broomfield. Your city council has not yet approved this expenditure. It must be approved by your city council in the future, depending on what the sampling results show. And so this is still going to be back on the docket. So be active to your agenda and appear at those meetings and make sure you keep track of what that sampling says.
This lady.
I'm gonna take like two more questions, you know.
I just wanted to address the gentleman that used to work at Rocky Flats.
Yeah.
Dr. Edward Martell found that there was off-site plutonium. That's why, actually, there was a Superfund site to the east of Indiana, and part of Candelas was in a Superfund site as well. So Dr. Martell was poo-pooed by the AEC at the time, so the AEC mounted a defense, and they used their physicists, Cray and Hardy. They went out and did their own sampling, and that's a famous study that not only was there in the refuge plutonium, but off-site, all the way out to Denver and Aurora. So don't be misguided. There was plutonium in Candelas and out by Marilyn Cook's place on 96, and it went way east.
In the soil.
On the topsoil, yes, because of the prevailing winds from the trenches, the leaks, the fires, it goes on.
I guess I'll go ahead, Dan.
Well, I have two questions. One is, what's the DOE's responsibility to continue to monitor the site? You know, what's the agreement that's in place? Is there one?
Yeah, there is. There's an agreement called the Riffle and Rocky Flat Legacy Management Agreement. It's an agreement between Department of Energy, EPA, and Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment. And it kind of outlines the monitoring requirements for the DOE to continue at the site.
And from your point of view, is that they're continuing to monitor? Is that a comprehensive plan?
Yes.
Would you agree that?
Yes. Because one of the things you have to remember is that at the time of closure, Broomfield had a seat at the table because the Department of Energy wanted the site to be closed, and one of you know, there were a lot of compromises that happened along the way. The DOE was probably pressing for less stringent cleanup requirements than what the local governments wanted, and those levels landed somewhere in between. But one of the things that Broomfield pushed strongly for was an ongoing monitoring plan in terms of making sure that the closure was in place, and then that the monitoring would be able to demonstrate ongoing protectiveness for the health and for human health and public and for the environment. And part of the issue and part of the challenge that we have is always that at that point in time, we have a safe table. After closure happened, we don't have that any longer. That's our biggest concern moving forward, is because now Department of Energy does not have any motivation to include communities. They don't have any motivation or legal requirement to consult with us and communicate with us in terms of what their plans are. And so our real leverage point is when we're looking at potential changes, like changes to water quality standards that Rocky Flats or Department of Energy had recently proposed at the city PHE, we oppose those. And so our real leverage right now for any changes at the site is really just EPA and the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment.
Well, you know, Johnson, who was the head of the health department for Jefferson County, while he was active in that role, constantly maintained that the contamination, much of the contamination that occurred there, occurred in the first 2 or 3 inches of the ground soil when those fires occurred, because that was released into the air, the wind carried those particles and spread them throughout, you know, much of that area. And so it seems to me that it would be imperative that there would be soil samples taken constantly as erosion occurs, you know, as the wind patterns change, to ensure that contamination that occurred isn't on the surface now and exposing people. I mean, they built along Indiana there extensively just in the last 2 years, just east of Indiana, I think. There's been a lot of construction. Was there any soil samples taken? Well, you may not know this. I mean, I'm just wondering what our basket was in. What their role was in that regard. It seems like that they would, I don't know.
You had a question or comment, and I wanted to go ahead.
I did. A year or so ago in the newspaper, there was some articles about it, and they were talking about the danger of if there was a grass fire out there, which led me to believe, and the reader was trying to say it, that actually the vegetation that was growing out there was bad.
Right.
So if all that stuff, we're not that far away. Is it actually in the vegetation?
There are scientific studies showing that, yes, plants take up plutonium.
So, Kristen, what is the safety deal with the Division of Fish and Wildlife?
That's May 15th at the Arvada Center, 6:30 p.m. And you're Sandy Pennington, right? The superior? Yeah, I just wanted to respond.
Oh, I recognize you.
Superior was the only municipality of the seven that said, no, we want nothing to do with this. We do not want our residents to go through. So you can vote no.
So
I wanted to just add one piece of information in fairness to the other governments, because they allowed us to present to the federal government that was pricing the trail project, to walk that alignment and go through it that we were proposing, and the determination was made that it was just way too expensive to go that route, and there were engineering issues. But the other governments, in fairness to them, they wanted to have that priced and review it. Now, you can still take the position, which I imagine you do.
Safety,
you should have
Trump's
kept
money.
Pushing it. Mm-hmm. But I'm just letting you know. And then we were able to remove that Walnut Creek access there. So that was a big concern to our community. So, you know.
But you're still going through a lot of contamination as you head south to join that trail.
Well, let's see what the sampling tells us.
Well, I was just concerned about, Kristen, is Fish and Wildlife going to do the sampling on the refuge itself? Or are your professional scientists that the RFP will hire going to do on the refuge itself?
You know, it has to be determined, but we just met a couple of weeks ago, and a representative from the Fish and Wildlife Service said that really it would be easier for them to just piggyback on our project and, well, use the same contractor and, and have that. But, you know, I'm sure there are many more people that have to weigh in on that decision than one person.
Because they're not trained scientists.
No, it would, they would have a contractor do it.
So, as I said earlier, this wasn't necessarily meant to be a complete public policy debate, but it was understood that public policy would come up, which is why, you know, David's here and Chris and Prince. I appreciate everybody's effort. I'm going to tell you, we're the Open Space Foundation, and we're going to move from global warming to Rocky Flats to wildflowers. So on May 24th, we have wildflowers. And so I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank everybody for, you know, for their participation. I want to particularly thank Kristen and David Allen. You know, so thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it.